For the moment, he's certainly ready. Is he ready to go beat Wisconsin today? No, but he's certainly ready for the moment, and he'll be ready when it comes to the game plan, when it comes to winning the football game on Saturday. He'll be ready for that as well.
Can you kind of walk us through what happened in the spring? He was the number one guy behind Braxton through the spring, through most of the summer. Was it more what JT was doing, or was there something that you were looking to see from Cardale you didn't see?
Yeah, no, it was certainly not any deficiency on Cardale's part. He was doing a pretty admirable job. It was the fact that JT was kind of just, I think I said the quote before, was just the offense was moving just a little bit better when he was in there, and there was really not a metric, I guess, to kind of say, hey, he's doing this better, but this not as good, and, you know, completion percentage. You know, we chart everything, we grade everything, and their grades were very similar. It was just the offense was moving a little bit better at the time when JT was in.
Hey, Tom, in the spring, on that same thought, you know, Cardale was the one, and he came in the fall as the one, and, you know, a few days before Braxton got injured, he would have been the starting quarterback.
Right.
How did you see him handle that personally, you know, being – pass right before that, and
yeah,
all the stuff that he's been through. I mean, he might have been the starting quarterback, and, you know, all the stuff that he's kind of had to overcome personally.
Yeah, I think that was tough for him, but him and I spoke at great length and great detail on numerous occasions about how to handle it, and he's done nothing but be a great example of how to handle that, and he stayed engaged in every game plan. He understands that he's a shoelace, or, you know, broken shoelace, or a broken fibula away from you know, going in, and he's taken that role very seriously, and I'm proud of him for it.
Can you draw any confidence from just the way he's approached it even before he knew?
Oh yeah, a ton of confidence. I think had he gone in the tank and been reclusive and unresponsive, then I would have been pretty nervous about this week. But the fact that he has stayed engaged and has prepared each week as if he was the starting quarterback, I think, you know, we got to get him ready. We got to accelerate the learning curve a little bit.
He's shown he's a good runner, and you guys run the quarterback a lot. Can you just talk? I know everybody's talking about his passing, but talk about his running skills, and can he be special in that regard?
He's a big dude.
And fast.
Yeah, big and pretty fast for that size. Probably doesn't have quite the same short range change of direction that JT has, but long range speed and ability to kind of open it up and stride, he's pretty fast. So, I think you guys have all seen him run the football, because a lot of times when he does get in, that's really all that we're going to do at that point in the game. But I'm excited to see what he can do. I think he's got a chance to be pretty effective at it.
With what happened with JT, would you be prone not to run him as much, though, considering Stephen Collier's your next in line and he's redshirted, et cetera? I mean,
yeah,
sort of the thinking there, Tom.
I don't think, you know, JT got hurt on a read play.
Mm-hmm.
You know, Braxton got hurt on a pass. You know, and so I don't think, you know, in order to run the football, I think nowadays you're really talking about three different styles. You're talking about, you know, the triple option of Georgia Tech or Navy. You know, you're talking about packing everybody in there with three tight ends and two fullbacks and maybe a sixth offensive lineman like Wisconsin or like some of those teams, and just out-gapping people and out-hammering people. And then you're talking about the spread run teams like us in Auburn and Oregon, where the quarterback read element of it is part of it. And so in order to run the football, I don't think you can ever take out the way we do our business. You can never take out the QB read element of it, but the called and designed quarterback runs, you could probably take a few of those out.
This is probably obvious, but is the toughest thing for a guy coming off the bench like Cardale is dealing with the passing game, meaning live, you know, defenses changing on the fly and stuff. Is that his biggest challenge?
Yeah, reading coverages and making split-second decisions will be the biggest challenge for him.
And how has he been in the classroom in that regard?
Great. I mean, great. He's really football smart, to be honest with you, Tim. He gets the game. He understands it. Again, there's always going to be some rust issues and some live bullet, you know, issues. But he's a really football smart guy.
Tom, we've heard a lot about JT's leadership ability. What do you guys lose with not having him in the huddle in terms of presence and leadership?
You lose a little bit of I mean, the guy's accounted for 45 touchdowns in 12 games. So I think what our team needs to understand is Cardale going to come in and account for 7 touchdowns in this game? Probably not, and doesn't need to, and shouldn't have that weight put on him. So to expect that as a teammate, I think, would be a little bit false. So we have to coach our guys that, hey, JT's not here. JT's numeric production might, you know, is going to be missed, but we'll be able to make it up in X, Y, and Z fashion, and everything's going to be okay. So the intangibles of the leadership and all that stuff, I think, are more in the locker room and day-to-day more than they are the 3 hours during game day, you know, during the game.
Passing-wise, Urban.
When you get a new quarterback in.
Go ahead.
Sorry.
Go ahead.
When you get a new quarterback in, how big of a concern is, not just with Cardale, but with anybody, just that they not be overwhelmed by everything that they're going to see and everything that's coming at them?
Yeah, that is pretty concerning, yeah. You have to manage it like we did. I think I heard a stat after the Navy game. I think JT threw 9 passes in the first half, and like 7 of them were behind the line of scrimmage or something. We didn't go in saying that, but I think you go in and you say, okay, there's some cautiousness here, because if you throw him in the fire too quick, right, he's liable to get burned. But if you let him, it's kind of like jumping in that hot tub, right? You got to kind of ease your way into that hot tub a little bit, you know, and knowing it's really hot and you're going to be just fine, but you don't go cannonballing into a hot tub.
And do you think that, I mean, there's some...
I don't, at least.
That's a great point, by the way.
Is there any danger that you think that college football playoff voters, whatever, could hold it against you guys because you lost a Heisman contender for the second time this season?
I don't know how all that works. I think that'd be crazy. Yeah. But so to say, do I expect it or not expect it or whatever, I don't know what to expect. I really don't, but I can't imagine that would be the case.
Passing-wise, Urban said that Cardale has a cannon for an arm. Talk more about his passing. Can you elaborate on it? Is accuracy and decision-making obviously the biggest concern? Just talk about him as a passer, if you would.
Yeah, really strong arm, really smooth, easy delivery. Gets off balance at times with his feet, and like you guys have heard me say on numerous occasions, a lot of accuracy issues start from the hips down. And so as long as he keeps his weight distribution good, his hips in the right place, his feet in the right place, has a chance to be as good a passer as I've coached in terms of accuracy plus arm strength, as long as, again, that's a big if we can, you know, keep the muscle memory intact and keep him and his feet underneath him at all times.